Hi everyone, welcome back to the Communication and Conflict YouTube channel, promoting mindful communication and growth through conflict. So today's video, I want to look at why bullying investigations cannot work for anyone involved. And I'm going to use this ACAS guide to bullying and harassment at work, a guide for managers and employers, to use as a kind of reference to explain to you why bullying investigations don't work. Now, hopefully this video will be of relevance to you in whatever situation you're involved in a bullying allegation, whether you're someone who feels they're being bullied at work, whether you're someone who's accused of bullying by a colleague or a team member, but also for perhaps particularly for people who are investigating bullying allegations themselves. But actually, hopefully you'll see it as relevance for all of you if you're coming from that kind of position or that any of those three situations. Because what I want to try to kind of point out is that none of the guidance that's available out there with regard to bullying investigations works for anyone. And I'm using the ACAS guide because in the UK, the ACAS, which is Advisory Arbitration and Conciliation Service, is kind of the go-to reference for a lot of organisations. And it does some great work. It produces some really great materials, videos, booklets, guides, etc. on various aspects of workplace legislation, management practices, etc. So I'm not intending it specifically as a criticism of the ACAS guide, but I'm just using it as an example, and because it's one of the main examples that is used for people looking for support in how to deal with bullying allegations, and why even within the ACAS guide it's very confusing, it's very subjective, it's very ambiguous, and this is the reason why so few bullying investigations get anywhere, because the approach is fundamentally flawed. So I'm going to say a little bit more about that as we go through. So I'm going to be referencing different things that it says within the guide, and I want to explain to you why that means it's never going to be the case that there's a satisfactory outcome to a bullying investigation, or even if there were to be a decision, it would still be very ambiguous. And I'm going to quote you some statistics which are even from another ACAS paper which identifies that, some work that's done in Australia where there's something that's been set up specifically for this kind of purpose but has still not managed to come to clear decisions about investigations into bullying and allegations thereof. So I'm going to start by talking about the fact that the guide is called the Bullying and Harassment at Work Guide. Now, the reason that's immediately confusing from the start is that bullying and harassment are actually very different things. Harassment has a legal definition under the Equality Act of 2010. It's defined under law, so therefore there are objective criteria by which you can assess whether harassment has occurred. Bullying doesn't have any legal definition. There are countless definitions of bullying. If you go on the internet, which is something I've done because I do a lot of work of looking into bullying, and I've written a book about it, as some of you will know as well, there are countless definitions of bullying. None of them are clear enough to come to any conclusion about whether bullying has occurred or not. And there are good reasons why, which is one of the reasons why, as I say, I don't think this approach works for dealing with difficulties at work that people describe as bullying. But with harassment, it is clearly defined. So if I read to you that definition, in the Equality Act 2010 in the UK, this is: harassment is unwanted conduct related to a relevant protected characteristic which has the purpose or effect of violating an individual's dignity or creating an intimidating, hostile, degrading, humiliating or offensive environment for that individual. Now, in a sense, all those kind of last descriptions are similar in definitions you'll see about bullying, but the significant thing about harassment is it's related to a relevant protected characteristic. That's the thing that gives the basis on which a decision can be made. So if I say someone's incompetent at work, which is quite a rude thing to say because there might be better ways I could address what I see as their challenges, but if I were to use that label, someone might say that's bullying. But other people would say, well, you're just describing what's happened. They haven't done their job properly. That's it. But if I say they're incompetent, but it's on the basis of them perhaps being black or a woman or a man or a Muslim or gay, and I'm using that as the basis for saying they're incompetent, that in itself is discriminatory. But if it were to persist, that would be harassment. So there's a clear basis on looking at how I've expressed myself and whether I am being discriminatory in the way I'm speaking, because I'm using simply their characteristic as a way of criticizing them. Whereas if I don't do that, it's not something that could be called harassment or discriminatory, because I'm not basing it on their characteristic. I'm just basing it on what they've done, whatever race, nationality, religion, sexuality, gender they are. So it's not discriminatory on that basis, and it's not harassment, which it would be if it continued to be on that basis. But with bullying, you can't kind of make that decision clearly. So one of the things that it says in the guide is there are many definitions of bullying and harassment. No, there aren't many definitions of harassment. There's one that counts. There's only one that counts, which is the legal definition. There is no definition of bullying under law, and so there are many, many definitions. So the fact that they're pairing bullying and harassment together is immediately an issue in terms of the guidance, because what it goes on to do is suggest that the way that you would approach bullying is very similar or even the same as you would approach harassment. And it can't be, because there isn't an objective criteria set to assess bullying, which there is for harassment. So, as I say, I'm surprised that they even pair bullying and harassment together in the first place. So I want to look a little bit further into what is described as bullying in the guide, and it will be very similar to guidance that you'll see anywhere else really about what constitutes bullying. So the ACAS guide says bullying may be characterized as, so it doesn't say defined as, which it does for harassment. It says it may be characterized as offensive, intimidating, malicious or insulting behavior, an abuse or misuse of power through means that undermine, humiliate, denigrate or injure the recipient. Now again, all of those things you could agree, of course, they're not pleasant things to experience. But the point is, with any of them, they are about a relationship between two people, or maybe more than two people, but often it will be between two people in the workplace, where one is perceived to be the bully and one is perceived to be the victim of that bullying. But the point is, it's about a relationship. So how people interpret each other and experience each other is subjective. Now, that I'm not for one minute wanting to discard or dismiss the fact that it's a difficult relationship between the two people involved, but it's subjectively interpreted. Unlike with harassment, where if somebody else hears one person say to the other person, you know, something which relates to their characteristic, their race, their gender, their sexuality, etc., their religion, then there's evidence immediately. It doesn't have to be it's not subjectively interpreted, it's clearly evidenced. So therefore it's a very different way of assessing whether harassment has occurred compared to bullying. Because bullying is in this way of describing it, is a subjective experience from both sides, but there's no objective way of assessing it. So therefore it's about interpretation of people rather than actual factual evidence of something that's happened. So that was the definition, and I will have put that up on the screen for you to look at. But then it goes on to And what I want to point out is, you know, I hope this is making relevance for anybody in the situation. If you feel you're being bullied, if you've been accused of being a bully, and if you're investigating, this is why it will be incredibly difficult for there to be any successful outcome from an investigation into bullying. So I'm saying that because I'm just saying that to consider other ways of dealing with this might mean that you actually come to a better outcome for yourself, because I'm trying to put across how it's incredibly unlikely you're going to get a useful outcome from pursuing a bullying investigation. From whatever perspective you are, you may feel that you're being bullied and that an investigation will help you, and I'm trying to get across that it perhaps won't. In fact, it's more likely not to than it will statistically, and I'll discuss statistics later about why I say that. But now I'm going to go on to looking at the kinds of things that will be considered as examples of bullying, so that again, if you're someone who feels you're being bullied, to understand why it might not be that you get the outcome that you're wanting, or if you've been accused of bullying, why the things that are looked at will be subjectively interpreted about what you're doing, and if you're investigating it, how it's going to be difficult for you to come to any kind of clear decision based on these kinds of descriptions. So so for example, we've got spreading malicious rumors or insulting someone by word or behavior. Well, you know, when a rumor is passed around, do people deliberately, when people gossip, do they deliberately do it maliciously? Do they sit back and say, I'm gonna spread malicious gossip, and then share it? Or do they just say something and then realize afterwards that the person's been hurt by it? So how can you prove it's malicious? You know, how can you prove it's malicious? Another one, and as I say, I'll be putting these up on the screen for you, so you'll see some of the ones I'm selecting out to look at as we go through. Copying memos that are critical about someone to others who do not need to know. Now, an example I frequently come across in workplace disputes is emails being shared, which kind of cause difficulties between people at work. So it might be that an email is being shared about a problem that's happened in a project or a situation, and someone has identified another person within that as perhaps having done something wrong. Now, it says copying memos that are critical about someone to others who do not need to know. Well, the original discussion is amongst a whole group of people, but what then happens is that someone mentions someone within that email, possibly not even intending to be critical of them, but the person hears it as critical of them, takes it very personally, and therefore suggests that that's bullying. But actually, it's just a consequence of a communication that's gone around. It may be that the person was wanting to point out the faults of that person, but the idea that you can select out who do not need to know when it's originally an email to a whole group about a project, it's very hard to separate that all out. Now, obviously, in time, when I've done mediations with people in this kind of situation, what they've chosen is that if they feel a particular problem with the person, they'll speak to them separately or email them separately. But in the middle of a discussion about a project, in a shared email situation, if someone just happens to say something that the other person is upset by, you can't kind of take back the fact that it was originally part of a project discussion. So the accusation is that it's been shared to others who do not need to know, but it was originally a discussion about a wider project anyway. So that's where the problem arises, but often it's seen as bullying because someone has mentioned another person within that communication. Unfair treatment. Well, who defines if treatment is unfair or not? Now, some people watching might say, oh, it's obvious. Well, it might be obvious to you that it's unfair on you, but it may not be obvious to the other person. It's unfair from their perspective, because they may have different definitions of what unfair is. So again, it's not a criterion that you can use to assess such things, because it's subjective. So the idea that these things can inform investigations, it doesn't work. It won't work. Overbearing supervision or other misuse of power or position. Well, again, some situations I come across in mediation is, in terms of something considered overbearing supervision, might be that a boss or a supervisor stands behind someone. Maybe they're working on screen, doing a spreadsheet, and the boss comes and stands behind them and points out things that they think they've done wrong or whatever. And obviously that's quite, you know, it's not the best way of doing things. And particularly maybe if it's in an open plan office, the person feels embarrassed, etc. So they'd rather it wasn't done that way. But to then associate that with misuse of power, as if there's some kind of deliberate oppression of the person. Again, it's incredibly hard to prove that kind of thing. The manager will be thinking they're just pointing out what's not being done correctly, that they're doing their job of overseeing and managing. But if the person says they're abusing their power, or they're misusing their power, or they're being oppressive, who's going to decide one way or the other? So you can't use criteria such as like that to come to any kind of decision. It's about the people themselves working it out together. I've come across situations like that where actually the person who's being looked over their shoulder has said, why don't you sit down next to me and talk to me about it? Or if you really need to have a long discussion with me, why not ask me to go into your office and we'll have a separate discussion? But don't do it in the presence of an open plan office where it feels like it's embarrassing to me. I feel embarrassed that you're just standing there pointing out all my faults. And the manager might say, well, I do it to everybody else and they don't have a problem. And that might be an entirely valid comment to make. So it could just be that this particular person doesn't like that, but it's not an abuse of power necessarily. It's you know, the idea that you can prove that that's what's happening, a misuse of power, is subjective again. And some people may say, I'm interpreting those criterion differently to how they're meant. Well, you know, that's the deal. You can't be clear about these criteria, about what is actually meant and what's actually going on. It's about personal perceptions. The next one on the list, and this is partly why I find it kind of quite confusing as to why they mix bullying and harassment: unwelcome sexual advances, touching, standing too close, display of offensive materials, asking for sexual favors. That's much more likely to be established or is proven to be so under harassment guidelines. It's a much clearer example of where gender sexuality comes into the situation, and therefore more likely to be able to be covered under harassment. And it's mixed in with these other ones, which are very, very subjective, which is why I think the guidance is confusing. If there was a separate booklet on bullying and a separate one on harassment, it would be much easier to make a distinction between the kinds of things that they're talking about, because very few of these other criteria described are necessarily going to involve any element of harassment or discrimination. They're going to be subjectively interpreted. For example, deliberately undermining a competent worker by overloading and constant criticism. Well, you know, people may feel overloaded by the work that they have, but often when people say that and then they do a comparison with other people's workloads, it is not necessarily always the case that they're seen to be having a different amount of work. It's just that it feels that way to them, and there may be reasons why that's come about. And even if it were to be established, the idea that it's deliberately undermining with some kind of malicious intent, how can you prove that? Now, you know, a lot of people, as I say, they might feel that this is an aspect that they're experiencing at work. All I'm trying to point out is that if you expect it to be proven by an investigation, you're very likely to be unhappy with the outcome. What that often then leads to is a suggestion that there's a kind of a conspiracy by the organization to kind of ignore the problem. But actually, it's not. Well, again, how can I ever know if it is or it's not? But if you look online and see the number of times that it's suggested that it's always a conspiracy by the organization, you would imagine that there's a kind of a global kind of network of organisations conspiring to always dismiss bullying allegations. And unfortunately, it's not anything conscious that they're doing, it's just that the guidance is so kind of weak and untenable and unsustainable, as is this kind of guidance, because you can't come to objective decisions about these kinds of things on bullying. You can on harassment, you can't on bullying, which is again back to I'm puzzled why they're always mixed together. So if you're making an allegation of bullying, or if you're investigating bullying, and of course if you're accused of bullying, I just want to kind of identify why these things will prove a challenge for you through that process. So the question then has to be, is that what you want as a way forward? Because there are other ways forward. So in a sense, just to kind of reinforce what I'm saying, there's a policy discussion paper which ACAS have produced. Again, another great example of the kind of work that they do to explore these issues. And this one's called Seeking Better Solutions, Tackling Bullying and Ill Treatment in Britain's Workplaces, by Justin Everson, Sarah Oxenbridge from Employment Research Australia, and David Taylor of ACAS. I hope I've said your names correctly. But one of the things they point out in this discussion paper, in a sense, almost reinforces the point I'm making, but ACAS don't seem to kind of actually integrate it into how they're moving forward with things in their guidance. It says, in January 2014, the Australia's Federal Employment Tribunal, the Fair Work Commission, was extended to include a new workplace bullying jurisdiction, the first of its kind in Australia and internationally. The objective of introducing this anti-bullying jurisdiction was to allow those alleging bullying to seek external resolution whilst remaining in their jobs, rather than have to leave their jobs and then have limited recourse, for example, by claiming unfair dismissal. Now, again, I'll put much of this information up on screen for you, but I want you to just take a little second to think. If I told you that 701 anti-bullying applications were made, so 701 requests for there to be an investigation into an allegation of bullying were made to this commission specifically set up to investigate bullying. So not kind of just a local organisation doing its best to do an investigation, you know, using the criteria given in the ACAS guide. These were people specifically employed to do the investigation. So a much kind of deeper opportunity to look into what bullying constitutes, to understand the definitions, the meanings, etc. 701 allegations of bullying were investigated by this commission. I'll give you a few seconds just to think, how many do you think out of all that number actually came to a clear decision that bullying had occurred and an order, as they call it, was instituted or made? So 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So I wonder what your number was, because the answer was 3 out of 701 investigations came to a decision that an order would be made about an anti-bullying order would be made. So only 3 came to a clear decision that it was necessary to institute an anti-bullying order. Now, it does say most claims have been either withdrawn, closed after a conference or hearing, or resolved during formal proceedings. In a sense, what do any of those mean? We can't know whether it was satisfactory for the people involved, or whether it just meant that people left and gave up on their claim. But the point being that 3 out of 701, so that's less than 1 in 200, came to a clear decision about they're being bullying. So I'm just throwing that out there, because if you do are involved in a bullying allegation investigation, I'm just trying to identify the chances that you will come to a clear conclusion are less than 1 in 200 by those statistics. It said most of these resolutions have involved agreements about future behaviour. For example, agreement that co-workers would not be rostered on together. Well, that's not a resolution. That means the manager now has to keep worrying about whether two particular individuals that they manage are in the same room together. That's not resolution. Resolution is when they work out how they're going to move forward in a way that works for both, so that they can continue to work together. So even the institution of one of the orders to keep them separate, that's not a resolution of the problem. So this is what I'm saying about the effectiveness of a bullying investigation, and even where there is an outcome, it's unlikely to be something that works for those involved, the people involved, and for the organisation. And obviously, when it doesn't work out effectively, there's a kind of a kickback against everybody afterwards, a kind of a backlash rather, not kickback, a backlash against everybody afterwards. And it's what I call a circle of blame in the book I've written about bullying allegations. It's what I call a circle of blame, and it never breaks. All the time, bullying allegations are investigated in this way, as if you can treat them the same as harassment claims, which you can't. Or you can, but it just won't work. So let's just be honest about it. It will not work to do it that way. So, in a sense, to labour the point, to really make the point clear, and again, this is within the ACAS guidance, which is great that it's there, but at the same time, it does still mean I feel puzzled as to why bullying is set alongside harassment, given that it's the nature of the two are very different in terms of whether you can do anything about them legally or not. It says, unless bullying amounts to conduct defined as harassment in the Equality Act 2010, it is not possible to make a complaint to an employment tribunal about it. So you're not going to get a decision from an employment tribunal about bullying. You will do and can do about harassment, and clear discrimination based on the protected characteristics, but you won't be able to get an outcome that about bullying through an employment tribunal. And the reason for that, as I say, is there's no legal definition of bullying. So let's be clear about that, you know, so that everybody knows. You won't come to a legal outcome if you allege bullying. So again, this is why I would say to respond to bullying allegations in a very different way to harassment allegations. Now, it doesn't mean to say you can't or shouldn't do the investigations into harassment. It's absolutely right and proper that they should. But if there isn't any suggestion of harassment, there is no point in doing an investigation into bullying, because there aren't any objective criteria by which you can assess it. I mean, unless you are one of the 1 in less than 200 that the Fair Work Commission in Australia managed to do. But as I say, they're specifically employed for that purpose, unlike most investigations within organisations. You know, they're probably going to be even less likely to come to a clear decision, or if they're more likely to, the chances are it won't be able to stand up to scrutiny. So, you know, it kind of doesn't work either way of the situation, because there's no objective criteria for bullying. That's the point I'm making. And then it's actually more about a relationship between two people that isn't working, and it's in everybody's interests to try to improve that. The second it becomes harassment, it's a legal kind of abuse or assault on the other person, maybe not physically but certainly verbally. But bullying is not. So therefore, the idea that there's going to be a clear outcome is a delusion. So why use a process that doesn't work? persistently. I mean, it baffles me really, because it's used the world over. This is why I'm saying I'm not specifically criticizing ACAS on this, because they're simply reflecting what happens in many situations and in many countries across the world. But it just doesn't work. So it puzzles me that there isn't a different approach being taken to dealing with bullying allegations. I want to go on now to talking about what the booklet suggests employers should do about bullying and harassment. So again, the two are being mixed. And obviously, a lot of what it says is good and proper and sensible. But again, I also think it's kind of standing back from being specific, because it knows it can't be specific about these kinds of things. So the first thing it says for employers to do about bullying to try to prevent it is a statement of commitment from senior management. Well, I've seen organisational policies, particularly public sector organisational policies about bullying, and they'll say things like, this organisation is committed to stamping out bullying, or will not tolerate bullying. And that's pretty much all it says. So it's saying it's not willing to tolerate something which isn't even definable. And just saying it's not going to tolerate it doesn't say anything about what it's going to do about it. So a statement of commitment from senior management is kind of, it would seem to me, a little bit pointless, because it's not actually saying anything of any significance. Acknowledgement that bullying and harassment are problems for the organisation. Well, yeah, great. That's fine. That's important. Let's not pretend that these things don't happen. You wouldn't be able to with harassment anyway, because people would have a legal right to have it addressed. But with bullying, again, very difficult to see how that acknowledgement transfers into anything actual and practical. Clear statement that bullying and harassment is unlawful. Bullying isn't unlawful. There's no legal definition of bullying. So how can you say that there should be a clear statement that bullying is unlawful? Yes, harassment, but why is the ACAS guidance mixing bullying and harassment again? Because there's no legal definition of bullying. And it's previously said you wouldn't be able to take an allegation of bullying to a tribunal. So why are they saying the organisation should have a clear statement that bullying is unlawful? Because it's not. Will not be tolerated. Well, how can you tolerate something you don't know what it is, and you don't have clear definitions of what it is? Examples of unacceptable behaviour. Great. Give examples of unacceptable behaviour, so long as they're not behaviours that would be subjectively interpreted. Statement that bullying and harassment may be treated as disciplinary offences. Well, in a sense, whether there's a statement or not, harassment has to be treated as a disciplinary offence because it's illegal. But again, even if there's a statement that bullying's could be treated as a disciplinary offence, good luck with the investigation in proving that it's happened. You know, if you do, your chances are less than 1 in 200 of coming to a clear decision. And the steps the organisation takes to prevent bullying and harassment. Great. Just take steps to prevent bad relationships developing in the workplace. But be clear about, if it's harassment, there's a legal duty to act against it. But bullying, again, how will you identify what the steps the organisation will take to prevent it if you don't have an objective basis on which to assess whether it's happened or not? And others, as they go through, and I'm pretty sure that actually, you know, with most of them, it would be possible to point out that they're kind of empty words, really, when you can't define clearly and never will be able to define clearly what bullying actually is without it being subject to continuous, ambiguous and subjective interpretation, such that you won't be able to come to a clear decision about it. So again, as I say, I really don't want to make out like I'm having to go specifically at ACAS on this. It's just that they are the kind of template that a lot of guidance is are based on. And so if even this guidance is so ambiguous and doesn't distinguish clearly between harassment and bullying, then it kind of means that that kind of ambiguity spreads to all situations where the attempt is made to investigate bullying, when you can't even know what it is you're investigating with any clarity, and you can't establish evidence because you're simply dealing with people's perceptions of behaviours. Whereas again, with harassment, you can actually find evidence, whether from the people involved or from others, that it has happened, simply through the bait on the basis that particular phraseology will be used, which refers to the protected characteristics. So, yeah, I won't kind of persist with the thing about what organisations can do, but again, hopefully you can see that even that is very ambiguous and kind of untenable as a way forward, with any kind of sense of clarity or certainty about what's actually being done to achieve it. It can be done through a tick box exercise by saying, yes, we're committed to anti-bullying, or we won't tolerate bullying, but it doesn't mean anything. It's empty words. So, all doom and gloom, it would seem, as if there is absolutely no way forward. That's only true if we think the only way of dealing with bullying is to do an investigation and try to prove that it occurs, as we do with things such as harassment. But there are other ways of doing things, as there are with anything. The whole point about conflict resolution, the way that the area that I work in, is that people can always create new ways of dealing with things, or just take up alternative ways that already exist. I mean, unfortunately, the consequences of only using this approach, which is by far the predominant approach to bullying allegations, an investigation that gets nowhere, people end up feeling very frustrated, very put upon, very stressed, very resentful. Number of people that I communicate with who, maybe years after they've left an area of work where they felt bullied, but the response has got nowhere, and they felt like it's a kind of a conspiracy against them, that there's been dismissiveness towards them. And perhaps that's the case, but actually in most cases it's because the system used to try to resolve it has just been fundamentally ineffective, and they felt like their challenges, their suffering, the things that they've experienced have just been ignored and they've been kind of discarded. But actually, in most cases, it's just that people aren't using a different approach, and organisations don't have options for different approaches to deal with it. And then you get kind of organisations setting themselves up, kind of campaigning against bullying. But actually, generally, how I would describe many of those organisations is that they're so kind of angry and aggressive in the approach they're taking that it's almost like they're wanting what I call a bigger bully to bully the bully. They're kind of speaking very aggressively and resentfully about people, in ways that actually one might normally associate with the idea of bullying. If I had any belief in that concept, which you're probably starting to understand I don't, I think it's the very label of bully and bullying that is the problem. That instead of us looking at the behaviours specifically, which will be different in any situation, for some people it's someone standing behind them pointing out all their problems and what they're doing wrong. For other people, it's people shouting abusive phrases and perhaps taking them very personally. For other people, it's about emails being sent out and then being included as they see it for criticism, and maybe sometimes it is for criticism, but there's a whole range of behaviors that get put into this box called bullying, and all the time they stay in the box called bullying and people don't look at the detail, it stays stuck. And particularly when people try to then prove it's bullying when there's no criteria by which to do so, it remains stuck. But when it comes out of the box and people can look at what are the specific things that you're unhappy about here, and both people, or all people if necessary, if it's more than two, both people can talk about what's happened and why it hasn't been working. And this is what I see people do through mediation. I'm not actually going to go into too much detail about here, because you're perhaps wanting a cup of tea by now anyway, and I'm going to do a second follow-up video about the ways that I see this being possible to move forward. It doesn't have to be through mediation, but it can be through a more mediation-like approach which acknowledges the subjectivity of the idea of bullying. Now, a lot of people can be very unhappy about that because they feel they're being bullied, they think the other person's a bully. I'm just trying to say here, if you're wanting an investigation into it, and if you're wanting proof that the other person is a bully and that you're being bullied, the chances of you getting that outcome are almost zero. As I said earlier, even in a framework set up specifically to explore that, they got less than 0.5% of cases actually came to a clear conclusion. So if that is the direction you want to pursue, you have almost every access to doing so, because almost every organization will do that. But I'm just, in a sense, just saying the chances are almost zero that you're going to get anywhere with it. And that might be frustrating, but it is that actually the approach taken to bullying just doesn't work when investigations are done. But I've seen sitting in front of me many, many people who, when they've talked quite, you know, strongly, in strong terms, about what their experiences have been of the behaviour of the other person, but stop talking about it, whether it's bullying or not, but actually talked about the particular thing that the other person has done, and of course the other person gets a chance to say in return what they see as their reasons why acting that way and how they've perceived the other person. But they're having a discussion, which means they actually say, okay, in future, what are we going to do differently so that this isn't an ongoing problem? And they resolve it, because they don't focus on proving it's bullying or not. They focus on saying, what is the problem and how are we going to move forward? How are we going to create that together? So you don't have other people in the room. You don't have representatives trying to prove it's bullying on behalf of one or prove it's not bullying on behalf of the other. Those people are out the room. It's the people themselves sitting in the room. And I am talking managers and team members. And just to kind of blow any stereotypes about that out of the water, sometimes the bullying is from the person who's the employee or the team member towards the boss. There are plenty of bosses I've seen, you know, very much kind of put under the cosh by other people in mediations. And so, you know, it has to be questioned which way the bullying itself, if there has been any, and as I say, not much point calling it that, but the behaviour, the difficult behaviour, has gone in both directions. But as I say, the point is, it's about giving people a chance to be adults with each other and to sort it out themselves, because there is not going to be a resolution by any other means, because, you know, the evidence is there and the world keeps turning over and over again, doing the same thing over and over again, but it doesn't change. And instead of actually people stopping and looking at, well, why isn't this working, they just keep doing the same thing over and over again, hoping that one day it's going to be different. And someone somewhere once said, well, that's the sign of insanity. Some people say it was Einstein, some people say it was Carl Jung. I kind of don't care. The point is, it doesn't work. It's never going to work for hopefully the reasons that you've seen me explaining in this video. And instead, as I say, of it defaulting to this kind of entrenchment where you've got people who feel they've been bullied, getting so angry, frustrated, they're taking legal action, often not getting anywhere with that, then finding that it's destroying their lives. Businesses are putting up bigger and bigger walls to kind of defend against the allegations, even though actually there's no clarity about what it is they're defending against. And it just getting nowhere. And yet, as I say, I have without question seen people resolve allegations of bullying through mediation. And it doesn't have to be mediation. It can be an aware or understanding manager who knows how to deal with such things. It could be conflict coaching to support one person in dealing with it more effectively, even if the other person doesn't want to deal with it. Just one-sided changes in actions can make a big difference in these situations. But the point is, bullying investigations do not work. As the title of the video says, they don't work. So what is it that means we keep trying to use them? Bullying is nothing like harassment. So to think that we can use the same approach to bullying that we use to harassment, we can't. And it clearly isn't working to try. So what is it that means that we're not using a different approach that allows people the opportunity to voice their anger towards each other, but in a way that isn't escalating it to aggression, but in a way which is allowing a proper discussion about what it is that's not working in working relationships. So I'm going to end it there. I hope you found it interesting and useful. I am going to say a little bit more in another video about how mediation can help with bullying allegations, to say a bit more about that. But my aim really today was just to point out how presently it's just not working. It's just not working for people who feel bullied, and there's nothing that is actually helping them with it, which is why it's just this kind of festering mess that's going on in, around a lot of workplaces, and people just feel lost as to how to deal with it. So I hope you found it interesting and useful. Please leave your comments below. If you did, please leave your questions. Please leave your objections. Please tell me what your thoughts are. Please share the video with other people if you think they would be interested to hear this. Please subscribe for future videos, particularly if you want to see the next follow-on one about ways in which bullying can be supported in being resolved. And sign up generally for the Communication and Conflict YouTube channel if that's something that you think would be interesting. Thanks for listening, and goodbye.